Hello? Is that on? Before we introduce Coach Gallagher, we're delighted to have one of our school board members, Mr. Sharp, is here, and he has offered to talk with us about a testing resolution. Mr. Sharp?
Good evening. School boards around the state have been drafting a resolution that would deal with the large number of standardized tests that are generated by the standards of learning. There are 34 of them as you go from kindergarten through 12th grade that a typical student would have to take. And they're useful to some extent, but they're not terribly useful as a diagnostic or a remedial tool for us at school. And it would be much better if we didn't have to do as many of them and if we had flexibility to be able to do testing in somewhat different way. And so we've joined with other school boards around the state, drafted a resolution. I think you'll see it on our website when we post for a meeting that the school board will have on Tuesday. I know your PTA leaders have been aware and have seen drafts. So please review the draft and give us some feedback as to what you think of standardized testing, whether there's too much, maybe too little, depending on your view. Love to hear from you. We're going to be trying to get the state to upgrade their testing program. They'll have an opportunity to do that. Both candidates for governor were proponents of reform of the standards of learning, and so it's something that is on the minds of a great many people. Thanks very much. Get back to me when you can. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sharp. Okay, so I think we're ready for what I know is going to be a really informative and educational topic this evening for you: a concussion update. What elementary, middle, and high school parents should know. I will tell you that I had the wonderful good fortune to come and hear Coach Gallagher give a similar talk a few years ago, and lo and behold, I have two children who play sports here in Mason High School, and my son did suffer a concussion, and I will tell you, I'm so happy to see all of you, because we just never know when it's going to happen. It might be sports, it could be slipping off a scooter, riding on right in your driveway, but because of the tremendous amount of knowledge that Coach Gallagher had shared with us, I knew what to look for, what to do, and how to work with her to support my son to a full recovery. So she is one of the most wonderful resources. The students just love her. She's very involved with athletics. I've decided she must have about at least three little secret clones, because every event I'm at, I see her all over the place. I don't know how she keeps up the pace. I think idolize is not too strong a word to talk about how the Mason athletes and their coaches feel about Coach Gallagher, as does the parent community. And I will also say, I can't think of anybody that the kids respect and rely on more. So one of my son's friends got injured in a football game, and his mom was really nervous, and she was sitting next to me. I said, I don't think it's so bad, because we were watching Coach G, because we knew if it was really bad, she would remember. And on top of all the sports work and the athletic training and the work she does during the day, she generously agreed to pull this presentation together for us and give up time in her evening. So probably one of the few evenings I ever have free. So thank you so much, Sandra.
Thank you all. I'm really excited to be here tonight, and it's been 2 years since we had our first presentation, and so much has changed since that time. You'll be happy to know I'm not going to put you through an anatomy lesson tonight, because you got that 2 years ago. But what I do want to do is give an update to you on all the tremendous developments that have transpired since the last time we were together. I want to thank all four of our PTSA organizations for being willing to sponsor this important conversation that we're going to have tonight. I really appreciate you doing that, because the more of you that have this information, the more you can reach out and pass it along to others. And I also want to give a special thanks to our superintendent, Dr. Jones. She was very instrumental this year in being able to transition my position to full time, which has allowed me the time really necessary to get in and stay involved with the research that comes so fast and furious, so that we can take advantage of it in serving our athletes and our students here. So thank you so much for helping make that happen, and that in big part allows me to do things like this. So thank you so much.
We're trying to get some sound over here.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah, this is the problem.
Oh. It's like they always tell me when I've got a problem on a computer, I call them up panicked, did you
Excuse
turn
me.
It off and is it plugged in?
Start.
Do we need to move this?
Yes.
Excuse us. My only requirement in doing any kind of presentation is that Steve has to be here for this reason.
And I'm happy to be.
Can everybody hear me now? Are we okay on sound? Okay, if I get started going too fast, because everything that we want to cover tonight is going to bring to mind a movie title. I don't know what the movie's about, but the title fits. It's called Fast and Furious. So I have so much I want to share with you tonight, and I know Kathleen's going to yank me off in about an hour, so I do have question and answers at the end. If we run out of time, I'm happy to stay as long as I need to answer any questions that you might have that we don't get to during the hour that Kathleen's given me. So back then, 2 years ago, this is where we kind of all came together to first have a discussion about concussions, and our presentation, Anatomy of a Childhood of an Adolescent Concussion, was kind of the springboard for a lot of things. In the time after that presentation was done and made available online, we had such tremendous communication from other school systems, both nationally and internationally. And I wanted to share that with you. We were contacted by school systems in Ireland, in Canada, in Australia. And nationally, we were contacted by school systems in California, Maryland, New Jersey, Pennsylvania. They had, while doing Google searches for information on adolescent concussions, they had come across the link that we had to this concussion. And the consistent feedback that we were getting was that, you know, we're just now starting to think about how concussions impact adolescents and teenagers. There's not that much research out there. You hear about concussions all the time, but it's mainly based on college and professional athletes. So they were so appreciative and so grateful to know that our school system had really been proactive in starting to think about that. So I wanted to pass that along to you, and hopefully you're as proud of that as I am, that we've kind of been on the leading edge of what we're doing with concussion management within our school system. So I just want to give you a quick overview of what we're going to touch on tonight. We're going to talk about our Falls Church City Public Schools Concussion Management Protocol. It's a comprehensive way of managing concussions for our student athletes if they find themselves in the unfortunate position of having to deal with that injury. This is relatively new in terms of everything that has gone into that protocol, and I want to let you know what that's about and how it works. We're also going to talk about the neurocognitive testing that we do. If you have a child that is an athlete in our school system, you know that prior to the start of each of their sports seasons, we do baseline concussion testing on them. For the last 9 years, we've utilized the impact concussion protocol, and that was developed by researchers at University of Pittsburgh's Medical Center, and they've been on the forefront of concussion research in this age group, and I did my training with them, and the impact program has really served us well. But this past year, in fact this past spring, it came to our attention that there was a new testing protocol there, and we were asked to look at it and see what we thought. And in working with it, we kind of did a trial run with our cheerleading members at the end of last school year. And what we came to find was that we thought it would be of more benefit to us. So I'm going to talk to you about that. We're also going to talk about something that is really becoming the trend right now. Everyone wants to know what it is. And when they find out what it is, they want to know, how do we put that in place in our school system? Again, the thing I can be proud of and sharing with you is, with the research organizations that we've partnered with, time and time again, they're telling us that Falls Church City Public Schools by far are outdistancing any other school system in the country in what you're doing with return to learn protocols for concussion students. So I'm very happy that we can share that with you tonight, what it is that we're doing. I'm going to talk about the most recent ongoing concussion research studies, what the implications of those are for our kids. Have some exciting news to share with you about some partnerships we've entered into for concussion research that hopefully the outcome of those projects are going to better enhance the care that we can give to our concussion students.
Oh. They want to hear it louder.
Okay.
Is that better? This thing's so old. Are you getting okay sound?
I'm getting that on my end.
Okay. Let's see. Do you think that works?
Is that better? If not, I can go into my Coach G tone, which goes up to this level. So you let me know if I need to go there. And then finally, we're going to wrap up with youth and contact sports. And you can't get out of bed in the morning without hearing something about youth and contact sports. So I purposely put that at the end. And I'll promise I'll save time to get into that. But that's what we're going to be talking about tonight. Okay, let's start by talking about Falls Church City Public Schools Concussion Management Program. It's a comprehensive program, and it's a team approach. And how we do, how it starts. If your student athlete has a concussion or is suspected of having sustained a concussion in practice, in a game, at home, like Kathleen mentioned, it's not always on the practice field or in a game when concussions occur. We've had some very interesting concussion injuries that had nothing to do with the sports practice. So when the child is suspected of having a concussion, two things we like to happen. One, we always want the child to be evaluated by a physician. And secondly, we like to be notified of that. And to make the whole process easier, I've become the point of contact. So it allows for some very seamless communication from the family to the school system. What we've tried to do is make it very easy and less stressful for the parents, because if you have a child who has a concussion, that's obviously going to impact what they're able to do at school. So rather than you dealing with the stress of knowing your child has a head injury, then you have to think about, well, who do I need to tell at the school? I need to email their teachers. I need to talk to the secretary for attendance. I need to let the principals know. I need to let the counselor know. Well, one call takes care of all of that for you, and that call is to me. And then I'm able to coordinate with you and with the school system on this end, so that it's a very safe way of making sure the information that needs to get where it needs to get is doing exactly that. Also, in communicating with families, what we try to do is encourage you, and we've had tremendous response to this from the families already this school year. We've already had 10 concussions this fall already. And what has been so very helpful to me in ensuring that the supports we need to have in place here for your child is the parent, the family, giving your physician permission to communicate with me directly. That way I can communicate and we can be very certain as to the extent of the injury, as to any adjustments or accommodations the treating physician wants in place. And then it allows me to share with your physician the supports that we have available and how we can work those together. So that's why it's so important, that initial communication. And it's just worked tremendously so thus far this fall. As we get that contact and we know that we have an injury, then the whole team comes into play. I immediately contact your child's guidance counselor, and together she or he and I work with your child's teachers, with the administrators in the building, and with the attendance secretary, with the health clinic nurse. So everyone that needs to know in the building that your child is dealing with a head injury knows, and you've got many sets of eyes on that child from the time he or she gets to school till the time they leave at the end of the day. So it's just like having a safety net follow your child through the day. We're aware of the injury, we're aware of how that impacts their functioning while they're here with us, and we can put that care in place that will safeguard the recovery. As we get a clear understanding of the extent of the injury, that allows us to create an individualized care program for your child. And there are many pieces that go into that. We take your physician's input. We take the test results that we have on file for your child here, the neurocognitive testing. We have their baseline profile available. We'll have the post-injury concussion assessment available. And all that information can be shared between here and your physician, and we can have a very clear understanding of where your child is in terms of the acute phase of the injury and how we need to move forward in protecting that recovery. And we're equipped to deal with that recovery if it lasts a week, if it lasts a month, if it lasts an entire school year. And in my time here at Falls Church, I was counting the other day because someone asked me how many concussions I'd seen here, and I think I was able to get pretty close. In the time that I've been here, I've treated almost 270 concussions here, and 67 of those happened this past spring sports season between the middle school and high school. So at this point, we have a lot of experience in shepherding you as a family and your child specifically through that process. And if you've been in the unfortunate situation of having to deal with a concussion recovery, you understand that it doesn't just affect your child, it affects the entire family, because it's not like any other kind of injury that you can deal with. It's an injury that affects your brain, which affects everything. It's not like a sprained ankle, where you can still do 90% of what you want to do. It affects your personality, your behavior, what you're going to be able to do in school, what you're going to be able to do outside of school. So it's very reassuring to know that we can have those services in place to protect that recovery. The sports participation, that's kind of the easy part of the protocol. There's always been a very structured protocol for returning a concussion student back to physical activity and sports participation. It's basically a six-day process once they've been cleared by a physician, and it's called the Return to Participation Protocol. And all the resources I'm going to mention tonight, I've made them available to Kathleen, and she'll make them available to all the PTSAs, and they'll be posted online. So any reference you see mentioned here tonight, you're going to have access to that after the presentation. So let's talk a little bit about that neurocognitive assessment. Why did we switch? The impact assessment protocol has been the gold standard for many, many years. But unfortunately, as you know, when something's good, other people want to develop something that's even better. And that's what's been the case with concussion vital signs. Concussion vital signs was developed by Pearson Education within their concussion assessment division. And Pearson Education, if you're not aware, but I imagine most of you are, that kind of is the umbrella under which we have our Schoology, our Power School. So it was nice to have a concussion assessment protocol within the same umbrella of our other modules that we use here in terms of communicating with parents, with families, with grading, things like that. So if you'll notice, the concussion vital signs, I'm going to start referring to it as CVS, it assesses cognitive and visual processing on a much deeper level than the impact test does. Specifically, if you'll notice reaction time, the CVS test assesses four different levels of reaction time, and reaction time is how long it takes the brain to process information coming in and initiating a reaction or response going out. So to have four different levels of depth in assessing that ability of a child's brain really helps us even more in refining what academic supports we want to or need to put in place. Some of the key layers of assessment that CVS does, you'll note, is executive function and cognitive flexibility, shifting attention. What's so key about those three areas of assessment? Executive functioning. That's one of the highest levels of functioning that the brain's capable of. That's the brain's ability to make decisions, to organize information and make sense of it, to link it to other pieces of information or experiences. Cognitive flexibility. Most of us would call that multitasking. How well can the brain shift between tasks? How well can it keep focus on task and prioritize which one should have your attention? CVS assesses for that. And then shifting attention. Our kids might refer to that as, oh, you're testing my ability of being able not to daydream in class. Well, kind of, maybe, but you know, in their minds, that's what we're assessing there. And in a very basic definition, that is what we're assessing. If we give you a task and let you get started on that, but all of a sudden we say, oh, while you're doing that, how about getting this done too? Can your brain manage that? Can it do two things at one time? But remember that this task is the more important of the two. CVS assesses that ability of the brain to do that. And then you'll see both protocols have online accessibility where you can just access the test protocol online. So no difference there. The difference, though, look at the capabilities with CVS. We can do a few more things online with CVS than we could with IMPACT. We can do a standalone symptom inventory. And what's so special about that? Well, we always want to track the physical symptoms of a concussion. How are they progressing from one day to the next, from 1 week to the next? Your athlete, whenever we enter them into the system, they have a unique athlete ID reference number. I can give that to you, and at home, you can pull up their profile online, go into the test format, and pull up a symptom inventory checklist, and do a symptom inventory on your child without needing me to do that for you. And then you can, once that's completed, it's stored in our account. I can pull it up online. You can shoot me a text or an email or a phone call. Vicki, we've got it in the database. Take a look at it and see what you think. I can do that the second I get off the phone with you and get right back to you and say, okay, this is what this is telling us. It also allows us to do a sideline assessment. A SCAT-2 is a streamlined version of an assessment test that we typically, that most athletic trainers have available to them on the sideline. We have that here. That's available to us. The big thing for me is the clinician portal. With the CVS system, take your child to the neurologist or to your family physician, and you know when you go in the office now, they're going to have their iPad or they're going to have their laptop with them right in the office. We give them your child's athlete ID reference. They pull it up online. They can see what I see. They can administer a test right in the office while they have you there. And it's seamless. I can see it real time. I can see the results. At the same time, your physician is seeing the results while you're in the office. We can communicate real time. So that's a tremendous feature in this test protocol that really pushed us to go to CVS. Before I get into research, did you have any questions about the testing protocol that we're using?
Are you the contact point for the high school, the middle school, and the elementary schools?
Yes.
If any student in the whole Foster City Health Schools gets a concussion, you're the contact for that?
I'm the one. and it's nice because I can touch base with your health clinic personnel at the different schools, and we can have conversations. I can have conversations with the building administrators, and that's exactly what we've been doing already this fall with the 10 concussion cases we've had. And we've had nothing but positive feedback from the different schools, especially from the guidance staffs, because not only do we do the individualized recovery academic plans for the high school students, we can do that for any student in any of our schools in the system. So to have that ability to be the point of reference so that we have central communication, the ball doesn't get dropped anymore. Everyone that needs to know knows.
Can you talk about, I know since you've been the leader and the school system's been the leader and doing this for the high school athletes, how we can think about rolling it out to do the baseline testing in middle school or even, you know, eventually elementary school, or you're working with the rec department or even some of the younger kids, because I know many people here whose children haven't gone through and had a baseline impact test,
right,
then be able to compare against when they have a situation, mm-hmm, you know, if it's really a concussion.
And that's a tremendous question, and it's one that we're still discussing with Athletic Director Horn and Superintendent Jones, and we're certainly, that's something that we want to move toward, but we're not there yet. There are time constraint factors, but we know that we have a lot of our students involved in youth rec leagues. We have a tremendous partnership with the City Rec League here, the rec department. So that's something that we're still in the discussion phase about, but it's something that we absolutely would like to be at some point be able to do.
Is the impact testing something that volunteers could help? I mean, I know the high school students come and you assess everybody or you get them started, but is that something that, just an idea that, you know, you have volunteers, you know, younger kids, or?
There are typically issues that come up, questions that come up about the test as the kids get into it, and you really need that training and medical background to be able to steer them the right way once they get into the test. Yes.
So I can go into my regular doctor with my grades. Like, is there an age, like a basic, are going to say a five-year-old is too young to go to that?
Well, I will tell you, I know five-year-olds are tested. There's not a lot of data on that age group in terms of, okay, these are their test results, what do they mean, compared to the middle school age population and the high school age populations, where we have hundreds of thousands of kids that have tested, and we have the data from that, and we can extrapolate meaning from those scores when we see them. Even though each kid's score is individual, we can get a generalized sense of, is it sort of in the realm of normal in that category or not? We don't have that information yet for those younger ages.
How often are athletes over at Mesa and other people at MH that are on the JV teams, how often are they tested? Is it once a year, or once you have that information?
We test every calendar year, and we do it prior to their first sports season, before they're allowed to engage in any type of contact activity. And then if they sustain, let's say we have kids that do their baseline testing at the beginning of the fall sports season, they wouldn't need to test again until the next school year unless they sustain a head injury. If they sustain a head injury, we're going to bring them in for post-injury assessments, and then once they fully heal from that concussion, we're going to establish a new baseline profile for them. So,
and you said that they can also, here, because I told my daughter is in the cheer program, so mm-hmm. You could also use that information if she gets a head injury not related to a Mason score.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. I'm going to move on, but again, at the end, we'll have time for additional questions and answers. There's some very fascinating and important research going on right now, and I wanted to share a little bit of that with you. This first one is probably the most expansive that has come out. It just was released last week. The final report hasn't been issued. The report that came out last week is in draft form. It's 305 pages long, and you're going to have a link to it after tonight. So it was very timely coming out before this presentation, and for someone who's a slow reader like I am, when I saw how long it was and how many days I had between the time I got it and the time this presentation was going to happen, I was a little bit stressed, but once you start reading it, it's so fascinating that you go right through it. So I'm going to give you the highlights of what the report said, kind of our own version of an executive summary, and then you'll have access to the full report. You can take your time reading through it. The focus of this report, and it was expansive, the focus was to really look at what the risk of concussion are for adolescents and teenagers, the developing brain. And that is the essential element of why we're talking about this. Most of the information that's out there, most of the equipment that's designed to protect against concussions, it's all based on adult brains. College athletes, professional athletes, their brains have fully matured. So the protection that they need is not the protection that our kids need. And so therein lies the critical reason that we need to do this type of research on this age group. How do head injuries, how does brain trauma affect the still developing brain? That's what the focus of this study was. The two things that you really need to appreciate are the gray matter and the white matter of the brain. As you can see, the gray matter is responsible for processing and cognition, your thinking abilities. The white matter helps coordinate that information between the different areas of the brain. So two distinct areas of brain tissue that have two distinct responsibilities. In a child, the brain will not fully reach development until about the mid-20s, until around the age of 22 or 23. Even though by age 6, the brain is typically almost fully the size of an adult brain by age 6, The organ itself is not going to be fully developed until almost the age of 23. So during that gap of age 6 to age 23, that brain is very susceptible to head trauma, and the fallout from a head trauma in that age group is tremendously more profound than if you were talking about an adult population. And these are the reasons why it's so critical in this age group. You're having rapid changes, dynamic changes, constant changes in the protective coating of the brain's nerves, the nerve pathways, the different elements of the nervous system in the brain. Until that brain has fully developed, the coating, which is called the myelin, the coating of the nerves that insulate the nerves that protect the transmissions, it's not fully developed. It's not fully intact. So if you experience head trauma, think of it this way. How many of you have ever experienced a serious sunburn? I wouldn't know anything about that. Redhead, never. You know, if you've got a sunburn, do you necessarily want to go take a hot shower if you love hot showers? No, stay away. Think of that scenario with the brain. Until that brain tissue is fully developed, think of that sunburnt skin. That's essentially the kind of protection those nerves have. It's sunburn, it's sensitive. It's going to be affected more by trauma than if it were fully developed, fully coated. Another critical thing that you have to realize is that the brain has its own special blood supply, blood flow, and glucose supply and glucose needs. When brain trauma occurs in the adolescent, the still developing, maturing brain, the glucose demands are tremendous. But what's unfortunate, when the brain experiences trauma, it immediately sends glucose rushing to the brain to help repair the injured area. But unfortunately, the response of the brain that happens at the same time is trying to minimize inflammation and swelling, so it's restricting blood vessels. So the glucose that's critical to heal the brain tissue is not allowed to get in as it should because the blood vessels are constricting. So you have a battle going on there in the developing brain. That's why trauma is so much more significant in children. Also, the sleep patterns. The brain is developing sleep patterns. They're shifting to later wake-up times for sleeping and waking. And we all know, when we were looking at shifting the start times of schools for teenagers, why we were talking about that, to give the brain recovery, sufficient recovery from day to day. The prefrontal cortex, the front area of the brain, where all the decision-making ability and regulation of emotions and risk-reward assessments, that area of the brain that controls those functions, it's still very much developing. And so while those nerve pathways are still trying to develop and make those connections to allow this kind of processing to happen, if anything interrupts those nerves or their ability to transmit the signals they need to, you're going to have a profound impact. In this age group, once they experience a concussion, while the brain has not fully matured, they're more susceptible than an adult to subsequent concussions. And the subsequent concussions will typically occur with less contact, less force. So not only are they susceptible to sustaining more concussions going forward, it's going to take less trauma, less force to cause even more substantial injury. So the recommendations that come out of that, and I'm going to hold off and get into those when we get to our return to learn protocol, in acknowledging and exploring why concussions are so critical in this age population, is because of how the brain is affected and how that's going to play out with the child's functioning in the school environment. So we're going to come back to that in just a moment when we get to our return to learn protocol. The Cleveland's Department of Neurosurgery and Center for Spine Health, in partnership with the NFL, they have just initiated a study in which they're looking at the sizes of youth neck to head ratio. And you've probably heard of the bobblehead theory if you've read or seen any information on youth concussions. It's called the bobblehead theory, and what that means is in our really young kids, 5 to 8 to 9 years old, their necks are relatively small and undeveloped compared to the size of their heads. So you have relatively weak neck muscles at that point in time with an unproportional head size, and then you put on helmet or protective gear and you're kind of top heavy at that point. The neck doesn't necessarily have the strength to support that added weight to an already in proportional weight on top of that neck, namely your head. So what this study is looking at, and it's being funded by a grant from the National Football League, they're taking measurements on youth football players from the ages of 5 to 8. They're looking at neck size compared to head, the ratio of that. They're examining the helmets. What they're trying to determine is, and right now, all youth football helmets are just scaled down version of professional football helmets. They're just scaled down versions. Is that necessarily what the adolescent head brain needs to protect it if you're going to be involved in that type of a contact sport? They're not so sure that it is. So the focus of this study is not to ultimately tell you that your kids shouldn't be involved in tackle football. It's to determine if they're going to be involved in tackle football, are the helmets that we're using with them right now, are they providing the protection that we think they're providing? And if they're not, how do we design one that will potentially give it that protection? Okay? Sports Legacy Institute out of Boston. The director of this institute is Dr. Robert Cantu. And if you've done any type of research on concussions, you'll see this name more often than not. He's one of the leading authorities on concussions. He's involved in working with overseeing studies going on right now with retired NFL players with the issue of chronic traumatic encephalopathy. And their focus has now shifted to adolescents. And it's kind of stunning to look at some of the numbers that they've come up with already. ER visits for youth concussions have gone up 60% at least over the past decade. And they think that number is not even close to being accurate because of the underreported concussions that don't get diagnosed necessarily in the ER. I can't tell you how many times we've initially sent one of our athletes to the emergency room, and the ER staff, they will typically do one test. And the one test that they typically like to do, stand here, close your eyes, put your finger on your nose. If you can do that, you don't have a concussion. I could do that if I were sleepy. You could do that if you hadn't had your Starbucks yet, okay? Most concussion kids, in the immediate aftermath of an injury, most are able to do that. And so, like I said, a lot, I can't tell you how many times we get a report back that, oh, they're fine. Well, what did they do to tell you that you were fine? They wanted to see if I could touch my nose with my eyes closed. They typically will not prescribe a CT scan or an MRI because they're concerned about risk of radiation exposure. So that one simple balance test is really what a lot of kids that visit ERs are getting that results in a non-diagnosis of a concussion. This fall, out of the 10 concussions that we had evaluated initially, 9 of those were seen first at an emergency room, and the majority of those came back as negative for concussion, only to find out in the ensuing days that not only did they have a concussion, they had a serious concussion. So that's what we're really trying to get at.
Yes? I've always heard that if your eyes will dilate, mm-hmm, and you don't have a concussion, is that true or false?
No, false. The thought that is so embedded in people's minds that we're still trying to correct is, if they didn't lose consciousness, it's not a concussion. Only 6% of all concussions, 6%, involve loss of consciousness. And that used to be how they graded concussions. They used to grade concussions 1, 2, and 3, with 3 being the worst possible concussion you could have, and that, to get that grade, it had to involve a loss of consciousness. I can tell you that a grade 1 concussion, which is the mildest, and if you can imagine, there's nothing mild about head trauma, but the mildest of concussions in this age group is really the same as the most serious concussion you can have. And unless you've been through it, and those of you here tonight that have been through it with your child, you understand there's no such thing as a mild concussion in this age group. And if you're dealing with anyone who tells you, oh, he has a mild concussion or she has a mild concussion, then that immediately tells you that they're not up to date on the most current medical knowledge that we know about concussions in this age group.
Is there any data on kids in CTE yet or not really?
This institute is steering their focus to that age group. And they're just starting to get some preliminary data in. And what's frightening for those of us in the medical profession is that the preliminary data that they're getting in on ages 13 and 14 year olds is that they're seeing some initial damage to the brain tissue that's indicative of Alzheimer's disease, that's indicative of chronic traumatic encephalopathy that they're seeing in the deceased brains of some of these NFL players in ages 13 and 14. So, but everybody in the profession readily admits we don't have enough information yet on this age group. The current study that they're working on is geared toward determining, do we need a hit count initiative? How many of you are involved with youth baseball? You know, if you know anything about baseball, if you know anything about kids that have played baseball, if you know anything about kids that pitch, you're going to talk about a pitch count. If you're a pitcher and you're under the age of 16 or 14 or 13, this is the number of pitches that you should be allowed to pitch in a game. You should not be allowed to pitch more than twice in a week, or you should not be allowed to pitch more than 5 innings in an outing. So we have a pitch count. We have a number of pitches that if you exceed it, it's bad for your kid's elbow. Why would we not want to think about that for your kid's brain? How many hits are too many hits for a kid's brain? People think when I start to talk about concussions, I'm going to really go after football. It's not just a football injury. We're talking about soccer. We're talking about lacrosse. We're talking about field hockey. We're talking about cheerleading. The focus on these hit count initiatives, they're initially going to start with soccer, and it's the issue of heading. If you have a child that's involved in soccer, already they have been able, through imaging of the brain, to determine a number when they see damage start to occur to the white matter of the brain in adolescence. And that number of what they're calling subconcussive hits. And that would define heading a soccer ball. That's a subconcussive blow.
There's some difference between girls and boys, though, also.
Yes, I'm going to bring that up in just a second. Subconcussive blows, it's not that great trauma, that crack of the helmets that you hear. It's just heading a ball. How many times do you head a ball in soccer practice? How many times do you head a ball in a soccer match? In any one specific practice session or any one specific game, not so many. But if you track that over the course of a sports season, over the course of a calendar year, you can easily rack up well over 1,000 subconcussive blows. And if you've ever had a soccer ball in your hand, it's hard. I have tried to get up the courage to head a soccer ball before, and not going to go there because I don't want something that hard in my head. But I know you have to know how to do it the right way. But the subconcussive blows, and that's the thing you have to realize, it doesn't have to be this huge, dramatic hit. Subconcussive blows, they've determined already that when a child exceeds 1,100 subconcussive blows, and you think, oh, that's a lot. My kid will never approach that number. Oh, yeah? That's what every parent of every kid that they included in the study said. So how did they track that? They literally had research members tracking, attending practices, attending matches for an entire calendar year. And they counted every time a kid headed a soccer ball. And then at the end of that calendar year, they did diagnostic imaging, they did CTs, they did MRIs, they did diffusor tension imaging, which is probably maybe a year away from being the gold standard in how to assess brain trauma. It gets at the deeper levels of the brain tissue, and it allows you to see how water, how glucose, how blood is flowing through the deepest layers of the brain. They found that once the kids exceeded that 1100 number, they were seeing deterioration in the white matter. So, real important study going on, and it's going to be, it's going to have a profound effect on how we approach some of our sports. I'll go ahead, since we're right in here, it's just a natural time to talk about it. Soccer headgear. I get asked this question all the time at the beginning of the soccer season. What do you think about the soccer headgear? Should we get it for our kids? It looks nice. Kids hate wearing it. If they know you're not going to be at their match, they'll come over and say, oh, I forgot it. And I can easily see it lying in their soccer bag on the sideline. They don't like wearing them. They'll wear them if they have to. Are they effective? The answer is no. Right now, there's not any helmet, any headgear, any mouth guard on the market that has been designed that will protect your child's brain from trauma, from a head blow. Helmets will protect or minimize the risk for a skull fracture. The soccer headgear may give you that edge of protection when you're talking about head-to-head collisions, the skull fracture. It's not going to control or prevent the acceleration of the brain within the skull, and that's what causes the damage. You have a collision. Inside the brain, it's still floating in that sac that it sits in. It keeps going. And when it hits up against the inside of the skull and it can't go anywhere, it starts shaking backwards. And then it hits against the back of the skull, starts shaking forward again. So it's that shaking that causes the damage more so than the initial hit. George Mason University Center for Applied Proteomics and Molecular Medicine. There is not another study or lab set up in the world right now that's doing this type of research on youth. And Dr. Shane Caswell is one of the two directors of this research study, and I'm proud to let you know that one of our former George Mason High School alumni is his graduate assistant helping him conduct this research. If those of you who remember Rachel Kasman, she was one of our soccer players here. She played basketball with us. She's in the graduate program at George Mason right now, and she is Dr. Caswell's research assistant, and she's one of the ones that is going out and covering the youth football league that they're working with. They're working with the Central Loudoun Youth Football League. They're also partnering with Prince William County Public Schools, with Marymount University, and they've been assigned to go to their youth football games, and once a week they collect saliva samples from the kids once a week, and then they're stored back in this lab. It's really futuristic. They store it, they freeze it, and then they test it, and they break down every possible biomarker that's contained in that saliva. So they're basically doing baseline testing on the saliva, and then if one of those youth football players sustains a concussion, they take another sample and do a post-injury analysis on the saliva. They've had 10 concussions thus far, and in 8 of those 10 concussions, in the post-injury assessment of the saliva, they found 60% more biomarkers, protein biomarkers, in those samples than were present in the pre-injury saliva. So they're really hopeful that they're going to be able to identify biomarkers that would indicate a concussive head injury. And if you can identify those markers, it might lead to us better able to understand how to minimize the damage that occurs in the brain tissue once it experiences trauma. So this is going to be this is going to be an astounding research study to follow in the coming year or two. Albert Einstein College of Medicine, I kind of got ahead of myself a little bit there. This is what we were talking about, the soccer heading, the implications for that. And then let's talk about a return to learn protocol. Up until the past 2 years, not a lot of thought was given to returning a concussion student to school. We know exactly what to do to work them back into physical activity and sports, but no one was really thinking about, should we work them back in? Should we progress them back into academics? And to think now that back then we didn't even think about the need to do this, it's just really, you know, it makes you think, what were we thinking? Because now, the more we learn about how the brain responds to this brain trauma, the more we know that a return to learn protocol is more essential, really, than a return to participation protocol, because of how the adolescent, the still maturing brain responds to this trauma. We know, without doubt, there's no guesswork about it. We know that cognitive exertion on the brain while it's trying to heal from a concussive head injury in this age group, cognitive demands on that will absolutely slow down or shut down the recovery process. So by returning a concussion child to academic work prematurely, we're setting them up for potentially long-term health risk. And I know we've had concussion cases here before this was really understood how much of a necessity it is, where we didn't have that protection in place, and where some of our kids who are no longer here, they're still dealing with the aftermath of a concussion injury because of how quickly they re-engaged in the school environment. One more thing I want to talk to you about that picture. It's a funny picture, it's a cute picture, but it's in the invisible injury because it gets at the heart of why this is so difficult for the kids that are going through this. When Ben had injured his knee and we had him in an immobilizer or on crutches, that's super easy to see. And it's super easy for his teammates or his classmates to, oh, how'd you hurt your knee? Is there anything we can do to help you? Do you need help getting upstairs? They're very sympathetic to that. You put a child back in the school environment with a concussion, they can be walking around. You may have no idea that they have a head injury. You may have no idea how much they're struggling. They look fine. But wait till we tell them we don't want you doing schoolwork. We just want you to sit in class and listen. We don't want you taking tests. Not so bad the first week. Second week that your child may be sitting there not doing classwork or not doing homework because we've said they shouldn't. Funny thing happens, not so funny for them. Their classmates, their friends even, they start to get a little jealous, as kids will. And then they decide, well, you're not hurt. You look fine. You're walking around. You're talking. You're just kind of milking this so you don't have to do homework, so you don't have to do classwork. To be struggling with an injury that you literally have no control over in terms of how quickly it's going to get better, you have control over a sprained ankle. You ice it enough, you'll get it better quicker. You can't do that with a brain. It's going to heal when it's going to heal. So there's a helplessness, a significant helplessness attached to this injury for the kid, no control over it. They can be fine, laughing, happy 1 minute, and the next minute they can be sobbing uncontrollably and have no idea why. 1 minute they can be doing a crossword puzzle, have no problems with it. The next minute they can't remember their home phone number. You can't appreciate that because you can't walk your brain around on crutches. Kids don't grasp that. And unfortunately, sometimes we know kids can be cruel. So we have to really be understanding of not only the cognitive needs, the physical needs of our concussion kids, we have to be really sensitive to the emotional needs of these kids as they go through these concussion recoveries, especially if they're extended recoveries. Not all youth that get concussions are athletes, but every one of our youth are students. So we absolutely need to think about how these concussions are going to impact them in the classroom. This is not an injury that you want to or should try to push through. And the biggest challenge, and I could easily spend 2 hours giving you the specifics of our return to learn protocol. I'm not going to do that, and I see some of you smiling about that. What I am going to do, the specifics, the details of our return to learn protocol are in a PowerPoint that I gave to our instructional staff at the beginning of the school year. You're going to have access to that PowerPoint after we're done tonight. After you have an opportunity to go through that, if you have questions or you want to get together and discuss that, I'm available and happy to do that with you. But for now, because we're starting to run low on time, if we don't have a progressive protocol in place for re-engaging that brain with cognitive exertion, we absolutely will impact the recovery time. We absolutely will impact the brain's ability to heal properly by exposing the brain to cognitive exertion too soon. We run the risk of causing permanent damage. And unfortunately, I've seen that. And that's not ever something you want to have to sit and have a conversation with about a parent if you're in the healthcare profession. If you had kept them home an extra week, we wouldn't be having this conversation. And that's a challenge because the first conversation that I have to have with our families is stress-filled. And the conversation centers on, we can't possibly have them at home. They can't possibly stay at home the whole day because they're going to get behind in school. They'll miss too much work. They've got this test coming up. They've got this SAT prep course that's starting this weekend. They can't not do that. Yes, they can. Because the bottom line is, you can send them to school. You can push the issue, oh, just try a half hour of homework tonight. Just try an hour of homework tonight. They can sit there and struggle with it. But the bottom line is, the brain's not going to be able to manage it. It's not going to be able to function to process that information. That's the challenge that we have when we first start down this return to learn road. And I always tell our parents and our kids, it's better to take maybe a week or 3 weeks or 2 months doing nothing or very little than to try to push through each day and end up costing yourself an entire school year, or to be 25 years old and not be able to remember what high school you went to. So I encourage you to take time to look through that return to learn protocol. I think when you see that, you'll be as proud of it as we are, because it absolutely safely progresses the child back into the academic setting while protecting that recovery. And I'm very happy to know that we're on the leading edge of that. There's no other school system in the country that has as an extensive return to learn protocol as Falls Church does. And that kind of leads me to this, and also back to that adolescent concussion presentation 2 years ago. In the meantime, since that time has transpired, Pearson Education and Anthrotronics. Anthrotronics is a engineering research organization in Silver Spring, Maryland. and one of their primary focuses is medical rehabilitation and technology. Anthrotronics currently has the government contract. They do all concussion baseline testing and post-injury testing on all branches of the military. And they have developed their own test protocol. It's called DANA, Defense Automated Neurocognitive Assessment. And they have tested hundreds of thousands of military service men and women, baseline and post-injury. But what they realized in doing that is what all of us in the profession are realizing. We need that kind of data. We need that kind of testing that's going to be that informative, that effective in this age group. So they are now doing research projects geared toward developing the best testing the best assessment protocol they can. They're even looking at, does it make a difference what device you run the test on? Does it make a difference if you're doing it on a computer versus an iPad versus a mini tablet? They became aware of our concussion education and management protocols that we have in place here. They approached us and asked, shared with us what they were doing, and asked us if we would be interested in partnering with them to help make an age-appropriate test protocol. And Pearson Education asked us if we would be willing to provide them feedback and work with them in even further refining existing testing protocols for concussion assessment. And so we were very excited to enter into partnership with them, and we began our initial study with them during this fall football season, and we're going to be working with our winter sports teams. And the information that we've gotten already is already led to refinements in the neurocognitive test protocols that are currently being used to test our students. So to know that the feedback, the experience that we've had with the testing of dimension here, it's already leading to a better test that's going to better serve our kids. So we're very happy that what we're doing here was so well respected, and that we're going to be able, by our partnership with them, to help make that available to all kids. And then kind of getting to the end here, Steve, this is where we're going to demonstrate. For those of you that have ever had a kid that's injured, you know that they show up in my office and we do rehab with them. We have them do crazy little exercises and get in the whirlpools and things like that. Well, we had a thought, and it was interesting. When we first met with these research groups, they were telling us about what they were doing. And I said, well, are you doing anything along this line? And the research and development director for Anthrotronics, his mouth kind of dropped. And I said, what? He said, we just thought about maybe we should look at doing that. And that is, we know we can rehab sports injuries. Why wouldn't we actively rehab brains? So a lot of kids who sustain concussions end up having visual processing issues and deficits. And specifically with visual processing, that's such a complex process. If you can actively rehab and help the brain relearn those processes, you're gonna assist that recovery. So we've explored the technology that's out there, and we've come upon so far two applications that allow us to help rehab our concussion students who are experiencing visual processing deficits. And I wanted to give you, show you just a little bit about what we're using right now. It's real exciting, and it's going to make a tremendous difference as we help bring these students back into the classroom, because what's our big push right now? Technology in the classroom, iPads, MacBook Airs, interactive smart boards. All of that is heavy-based in visual processing. So if we know that a kid is having deficits in that, if there's something that we can actively do to assist that in redeveloping, then that's going to be tremendous benefit to that child. And I'm so excited that we've got that ability. So we're good? So I'm just going to go through a couple of these. And these are available at the App Store on your iPad. And so you're going to see what I'm going to see. And I'm going to risk embarrassing myself by taking a couple of these tests. And if you laugh too much at me, I'm going to pull one of you up here and put you through one of these tests. Okay. I thought this would be a fun way to end up. The first application is called Vision Tap. And let's start with Speed Tap. Okay. And what this is going to do, there's going to be a circle that appears on that screen, and I'm going to have to tap it, and then it's going to go away and move somewhere else, and I'm going to have to tap it. So this is involving a lot of processing in my brain, and keep in mind I haven't had any coffee since 5 o'clock this morning, so that's my excuse if I don't get this as fast as as one of our kids might. So anyway, let's go. Here we go. So this is how it works. I'm going to have 30 seconds to try to hit these circles as quickly as I can. So you get the idea with that one. And we have the ability to control the speed of how quickly those dots appear. So if we are just beginning to work with a child with visual processing deficits, we can put the speed of those dots appearing at a very low level and progressively retrain the brain on how to make those connections. Tact tracing. Okay, this one's kind of challenging. I can't imagine having to do this with a concussion, but here we go. A design is going to appear on the screen very quickly and then very quickly disappear, and then I've got to be able to trace what I saw. And I have to be pretty much on the mark. And you'll get immediate feedback on how close or how far off you were. And not only do I have to get the shape right, I have to get the location right.
Now you're just showing up.
Now I'm just showing up. I will not tell you how long I practiced this today. Okay, so that's that one. And I'll do one more for you. Okay, this one is pretty challenging. Numbers are gonna flash very quickly. I've got to find the numbers on the screen and then remember the numbers and remember the order in which they appeared and type that in. I didn't even see the third one that time. All right. So that's Vision Tap. There are, these are the different types of tests or different types of games that I can run with the kids with the visual processing. The other one that we're using right now is called visual attention. And you have a choice of what you want them to have to do. Let me just show you one of these, because they're, once you see one, you understand how the others work. This is going to be letters within symbols that I'm going to have to pick out. Okay, so once it starts, the program is going to time me on how long it takes me to locate, in this instance, the W. And you'll see that I found 21 of 26. So as you go through these different games, you will either be asked to find a symbol or two symbols that are similar to each other. I'm sorry? Oh, okay. Well, that, but you got to see part of that one, right? Okay, great. Okay. Steve, how do I get back on the other? Yes. I promise 5 minutes, and then I'll wrap it up. Are you okay for 5 minutes? Promise. Youth and contact sports, it's a very emotional issue. It's a very passionate issue, regardless of which side of the fence you are on that. I'm not going to tell you whether I think you should or you shouldn't. I think what's important is for you to have the information that both sides proffer so that you can make an informed decision as a family. I love the game of football. I love soccer. Is there risk in that? Absolutely. What you have to understand, you know, how do you make that decision? The primary arguments are, one, the younger you start teaching proper technique involved in contact sports, and primarily this is targeted with football right now, with youth football, the Heads Up football program in partnership with the NFL, the focus of that program is to create a universal language among coaches involved in youth football across the nation. Universal language with regard to tackling technique. And they've developed a five-step technique that is taught to youth football players. You go through these five steps. If you go through these five steps, and each step has a specific name, if we train our youth on how to go through those five steps when tackling someone, then we significantly reduce the danger or the risk of them sustaining a head injury. And the program targets training coaches. Most of our youth football teams are coached by volunteer coaches. And in the past, you might have one league that teaches tackling one way, you might have another league that teaches a different way. There was no centralized method or technique. So you might have a really sound instructional technique being taught in one league and not so much in another league. So this whole program, the Heads Up Football, is designed toward creating a universal language, a standardized technique of teaching tackling, focus on training the coaches to teach it the proper way in an effort to minimize the risk for head injury. The other side of that argument is because of the neck to head size ratio in youth, because the brain is still maturing, because the helmets and equipment's designed to provide safety for the youth, because, and we talked about that earlier, the helmet issue, the neck to head. What you can't argue there is anatomy. You absolutely can't argue the fact that the neck is proportionally smaller and weaker in comparison to the head size than an older athlete. That's a concern. We know that the helmet is a scaled-down version of a professional helmet. That's a concern. So until such time that we can address those issues, the folks on that side of the fence aren't comfortable with youth being involved in contact sports. And the number you hear tossed about most of the time is age 14. Kids shouldn't play contact sports earlier than age 14. Is that number based on scientific research? No. It's an arbitrary number, and I'll tell you how they came up with that number. It's the age that most people are starting high school. They think if you can delay contact at least until the time a child reaches high school, then you've gotten them toward the latter half of that brain maturation period. So I know I ran long and we're having to kind of speed through this, but that in essence are the two arguments for and against having youth participate in contact sports. And there are no easy answers to that question, should they or shouldn't they. What we do know is that we need to know more. We need to do more. We need better equipment. We need better ways of dealing with the anatomy issue. We need, how do we strengthen a youth's neck? And we're just beginning to realize that it's important to look at core strength too. If you have a weak core strength, when you get knocked back to the ground and your core is weak, you're gonna be more likely to have that whiplash effect. Your back hits, then your head whiplashes back and then forward. If they have a strong core, they can tense up if they see the contact coming and minimize the force of that whiplash motion. So there's no one simple answer to how do we address this concern of youth being involved in contact sports. There are gonna have to be a lot of pieces that come together to make it something that most people can feel a little bit more comfortable with. You know, the sentiment that keeps coming coming out is no head trauma is safe head trauma, whether we're talking child or adult, but we're talking kids. And I'm going to leave it at that. I'll be happy to talk with you on the side or individually about that. It's not something that can be talked about or resolved quickly. The leading experts in the country don't agree on this issue. Dr. Cantu in Boston and Dr. Kevin Geikowitz at UNC Chapel Hill, they are by far two of the top three experts internationally on concussions. They disagree on this.
Would you provide, like, we've talked a lot about when a concussion already happens and how you treat it and readiness learned, but could you provide information over, you know, the next speech or the next iteration of those doctors, like what can we do if you know your child wants to play sports, what are the things you can do to prevent it, whether it's core strength exercises or neck exercises or just links to the different opinions of you can't prevent it or you can, here's how.
You've got those links. Let me go through and just show you.
That's the same. So those studies that talk about what to do after, also talk about before.
Yeah, okay. I've provided all of those to Kathleen, and we're going to make those available online. And don't hesitate to touch base with me if there's information or questions that we didn't have time to get to today. I'll be happy to stay tonight or talk with you, you know, anytime going forward. Phone call, email, if you want to set up a time to meet, I'm happy to do that. Sorry I ran a little late tonight. Thank you so much for coming.